This week we're going to cover two chapters, 14 and 15, so we might as well get started. Chapter 14 is about sleep. If I can get this going, there we go. Most creatures display a daily rhythm that approximates 24 hours. This is known as the circadian rhythm. Circadian is Latin for around the day, circadian. Animals who are awake at night and sleep during the day, like most rodents, are called nocturnal. Animals that are awake during the day and asleep during the night are called diurnal. This behavior may be controlled through the animal's hormonal structure, including humans, of course. When a creature is not given definite external cues, such as in the winter, they must maintain their own cycle, a process known as free running. When an animal, including man, is allowed free-running circadian rhythms with no external cues, they tend to run a little behind 24 hours. Any cue that an animal uses to synchronize their rhythm is called a Zeitgeber, which is German for time giver. When we were stationed in Germany, we were medics, so medics have to practice setting up mobile hospitals and breaking them down. One of the places that we would set up our mobile hospital was in a tunnel. The Germans actually built all these tunnels during World War II, and they're still there, of course. And since we were there, we just utilized some of these military tunnels. So we would go into the tunnels and set up our mobile hospital. And we would stay in there and we would practice for a number of days, usually for about a week. And during that time, we stayed in, almost everybody had to stay inside the, mountain, inside the tunnel. So it was dark inside. And of course, there were lights. They could turn the lights off, but it was really dark. So that rarely happened. So we were pretty much on free-running time. It was kind of interesting, too, because after about a week, it was actually 6 days. After 6 days, we went outside, and of course, we could see our watches. But for some reason, there was something going on in this cave, so our watches ran slow. All of our watches ran slow. Something was the iron or magnetism or something was going on. Hopefully it wasn't radioactivity. I guess if it was radioactivity, we wouldn't be here anymore. But, after about 6 days, we went outside and everybody thought it was like, noon, 11 o'clock or whatever. It turned out to be like 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and everybody was just shocked because we were going outside, and this was in the fall. Yeah, it was in the fall, and of course, days were getting shorter. So when we went outside, it was kind of dark, and Germany is really pretty far up north. It was about on the same parallel as the Canadian border, so. Yeah, it was kind of interesting. We lost all that time. As weird as that is. Researchers have discovered that a small region in the hypothalamus called the suprachiasmatic nucleus, or the SCN, serves as a circadian oscillator. The SCN triggers metabolic activity. Remember, most of our metabolism occurs while sleeping, so... that was the deal. One of the problems we had was waking people up and going to sleep. Some people had insomnia while they were underground or in the tunnel, anyway, in the cave. And other individuals would fall asleep and they'd sleep for 8, 9, 10 hours, and it was difficult to wake them up. When they did wake up, they were really tired. So the circadian rhythm was really messed up because we had no light cues to tell us what time it was, since the light was on pretty much all the time. Supercosmetic nucleus is the master pacemaker. Pacemaker. Lesions of suprachiasmatic nucleus abolish free-running rhythms. Activity in the suprachiasmatic nucleus correlates with circadian rhythms. Isolated suprachiasmatic nucleus continues to cycle. If you transplant the suprachiasmatic nucleus, it imparts the rhythm of the donor. And of course, we've done this with rodents, we've done it with pigeons, and whatever the donor, whatever their circadian rhythm was, it transfers to the individual that is gaining the transplant. We normally produce different intensities of electricity in our brains. While we are awake, we produce short, rapid waves known as beta waves. When we are relaxed or drowsy, we will produce alpha waves. So this is what we look like when we're awake, and they become much taller and a little bit farther apart. These are alpha waves. In stage one of sleep, we begin producing theta waves. This is stage one, and as if you remember what we had before, there we go. So these are really, really close together, relatively short and really close together. These not quite as close together, and they're longer. And as we move into theta waves, of course, they spread out even more. They're less intense, and they're spread out even more. And those are theta waves. In stage two sleep, we produce theta waves with sleep spindles, and this is a sleep spindle right here. The sleep spindles represent those really strange dreams that you have that are really quick and really intense. In stage three, delta waves first appear. In stage four, the majority of the waves are delta waves. The last stage is marked by rapid eye movement, and this is referred to as REM. And as you can see, as you fall deeper and deeper into sleep, the brain waves become more and more spread out, and these are the delta waves. This is where you get all your rest. This is where you regenerate your energy, and this is what REM looks like. Now, REM actually looks a lot like, whoops, looks a lot like this is when you're awake. Whoops, my goodness, and this is REM. So as you can see, it looks a lot like you're awake. In stage one and two, the individual is often not aware that they are asleep. They're unresponsive to the external environment. Stage three and four is the most relaxing form of sleep. However, it is during these stages that most people do their sleepwalking and talking early in the night when these stages are much longer. And as you can see, this is awake. This is stage one sleep. There's your sleep spindle right there. This is stage two sleep. Theta waves and stage three and stage four, we're heading into delta wave territory, and then REM, rapid eye movement. During REM, all the movement is suspended. In other words, you are paralyzed. The heart rate is increased, the blood pressure is up, the brain activity is at a waking level. The most vivid dreams occur during this stage. If denied REM, the individual will begin to act psychotic. So we're not exactly sure what's going on. We're not exactly sure why you need REM sleep in order to dissipate your psychosis. But if we can keep people out of REM sleep, they will begin having hallucinations and delusions. They become psychotic. And this is the sleep cycle over an 8-hour period. As you can see, this is them awake, and then they fall asleep, and they slowly drift into delta wave sleep. And then they slowly come out of delta wave sleep, and then they're in REM sleep, and then they go down again. And of course, the second time, they're in delta wave for a much longer period of time. They go back up to REM again. And then they don't really return to delta wave sleep. So if you could sleep for 2 or 3 hours, potentially you could get all the rest that you really needed. This is when all your metabolism takes place, right here in stage four, stage three and stage four sleep. But obviously we need all the other stages of sleep, because if you don't have REM sleep, if you don't dissipate something, there's something going on in our brains, then we will become psychotic. So you have to be really careful that you get sleep. As the night progresses, the length of time a person spends in REM increases. Dreams in REM in the first part of the night tend to be realistic, while those toward morning are longer and more vivid. People actually dream throughout the night, with realistic dreams happening in non-REM sleep and more vivid imagery happening during REM. Individuals who are depressed tend to have more dreams that are more intense than normal. It is thought that the excess dreaming is due to a state of hyperarousal from excess worrying. Night terrors occur in the early hours of sleep cycle while the sleeper is in stage 3 or 4. Night terrors are more prevalent in males than females and tend to be more common in children. It is almost impossible to wake someone from a night terror, and they often strike out at the person trying to awaken them. And this is one of the things that happened during the Vietnam War. Soldiers were coming back from the war, and they were having night terrors that had to do with their combat in Vietnam, and they were actually attacking their wives, and a lot of people lost their marriages because the husband, the wife was worried about her husband. He was making noise and he was moving around, and she would try to wake him up, and of course he wouldn't wake up, and in his dream, she was an enemy, and so he would attack her. Not that uncommon during the war in Vietnam. And of course, we were trying to support the war. The government was trying to support the war, so they didn't want to admit that there was any problem. So they just kind of ignored it. No, he had problems before. They didn't decide that PTSD was anything until the 1980s. So here we had all these guys with PTSD drinking problems and drug problems, and the federal government was pretending that nothing was wrong, even though there were millions. I think the figure on the number of men that served in Vietnam was kind of a long war. It was 7 or 8 years long. 8 million men served in Vietnam. 12 million men served during the conflict. Is that right? I think it was, the number's 8 million. Anyway, it's quite a few people. Nightmares occur in REM sleep and happen in more to girls than to boys. These dreams seem to be longer in duration and occur late in the sleep cycle when REM is dominant. So you'd have night terrors early in the night. So somebody goes to bed at 10 o'clock, around 11 or 12, they would have night terrors. If somebody went to bed at 10 o'clock, they would probably have nightmares about 6 or 7 o'clock, 5, 6, 7 o'clock in the morning. Humans are of different ages sleep differently. Most infants do not develop stable sleeping patterns for several weeks after birth, and this is one of the reasons why parents are really strung out during the first month or two months after the baby, after they bring the baby home from the hospital. And the reason is because the baby doesn't have a stable sleep pattern. So you never know when the baby's going to be asleep. If you're asleep, he's awake, or she, whichever the case may be. Premature infants may spend as much as 80% of their sleep in REM. A full-term infant will spend about 50% of their night in REM. REM sleep declines as people age, but it accounts for about 20% of the sleep in an average adult. Sleep deprivation studies have been conducted on subjects, and it was demonstrated that after a prolonged period of time, the individual showed signs of hallucinations, irritability, difficulty in concentration, and disorientation. But these symptoms seem to be more pronounced in the morning and nearly absent in the late afternoon and early evening. After losing sleep, an individual will not have to sleep enough hours to get back all the hours that they lost. Instead, the individual will spend more hours in select stages of sleep. The first night, the individual will spend an increased number of hours in stage four sleep to regenerate your body. The second night, the individual will spend a longer time in REM, and their dreams will be more intense. So it takes 2 days to recover from loss of sleep. The first night, they will spend more time in stage four, and the second night, they'll spend more time in REM. The basal forebrain in the back portion of the frontal cortex in the front of the hypothalamus is crucial for shortwave sleep. Neurons in the area are activated by sleep and use GABA as a neurotransmitter to inhibit other areas of the brain. Norepinephrine inhibits the area. The pons signals the brain to begin REM sleep. It is GABA and glycine in the pons that inhibits the motor neurons from reaching their action potential in the spinal column. Thus, during REM, a sleeper's muscles aren't just relaxed, but they're flaccid. They have a complete loss of muscle tone. So the longer period you spend in REM, the more your muscles are, can't, they not only are they paralyzed, but they're completely atonal. In other words, they're completely relaxed. It's more like being dead than anything else. Reticular formation is a collection of systems whose activity creates states of cortical arousal. Activation produces heightened awareness and arousal. Damage produces comatose conditions. Existence of different systems is indicative of the fact that there are different types of arousal. Different components of reticular formation use different neurotransmitters. The locus coeruleus uses norepinephrine. The raphe nuclei uses serotonin. Activity changes excitability of cortical neurons. Neurons are more active, more responsive to inputs. And that's your reticular formation right there in the middle. And of course, if you damage that, then it will make you comatose. What is the reticular activating system about? It wakes you up when you need to wake up. So if some crisis occurs when you're in deep sleep or you're in REM or you're in stage four sleep, normally you can't wake up. But if some crisis occurs and you recognize it, then it forces you to wake up. Now, this is kind of bizarre. So if you've got a baby and the baby starts crying at 2 o'clock in the morning or 1 o'clock in the morning, it'll wake you up. It wakes everybody up. It wakes everybody up in the house because there is a crisis taking place and the baby's cry is recognized by everybody and everybody wakes up to make sure that the baby's taken care of. That's what the reticular activating system is for. If you're on call, I used to be on call, for the lab, when I was on call, if it was 2 o'clock in the morning and they called me to come in to take care of an emergency, I would wake up to the telephone ringing. Why? Normally I wouldn't wake up, but because my brain was telling me that there was a crisis, the reticular activating system would tell me that there was a crisis, I'd wake up. Without any problems. Of course, I'd be kind of grouchy, but I'd wake up anyway and go in and take care of what needed to be taken care of. That's what the reticular activating system is all about. This area, if it's damaged, it will cause the individual to go into a coma. Now, normally, you can see it's right in the middle of the spinal column. It's kind of hard to damage this area, to damage it permanently. A lot of times what will happen is the area will get bruised, the area there will be a blow to this area of the brain, and the tissue around it will swell. and that will cause the reticular activating system to go into a coma. And it won't relieve itself, it won't come out of the coma until all the swelling is gone. And sometimes this takes an extended length of time. And that's why people go into comas. One of the reasons why people go into comas. So a lot of times, all you need to do is wait for the swelling to go down. But the swelling, of course, sometimes there's re-injury. It takes a while. Brain tissue is very, very sensitive to these kinds of things. So a lot of times it takes a bit longer. It's not like an ankle or a wrist that if you leave it alone and don't irritate it, it'll go away after a couple days. That's not usually the way that brain tissue works. That's one of the reasons why people will go into a coma and you won't be able to get, they won't come out of the coma for 2 or 3 or 4 weeks. Sleep conserves energy. Sleep allows it. So why do we go to sleep? Well, sleep conserves energy. It allows animals to be inactive when their major predators are active. Sleep restores the body. Sleep aids memory consolidation. Sleep consolidates material learned while awake. A good example of sleep allowing animals to be inactive during their major predator when their major predators are active would be rodents are very active at night looking for food and whatnot. Most animals are asleep, especially carnivores that would eat them. Dogs, cats hunt at night a lot, and the reason is because they're looking for the nocturnal animals. Dogs are primarily diurnal. They don't hunt at night. Foxes, almost all canines are diurnal. They hunt during the day. So the question would have to be, why in the world do humans sleep at night? Why don't we sleep whenever we sleep? Or do we have any major predators? Well, as we were evolving, yeah, we did. We had major predators in the big cats. And bears, and most of those animals are diurnal. Oh, wait a minute. We need to sleep at night. So oh, I don't know. I'm not exactly sure what would hunt us at night. I don't know. That made sense until I started talking about it. So I guess I'm mistaken. Unless they were night hunters, unless they were nocturnal. I'm not sure what does hunt at night. Somnambulism, of course, that was in our ancestral past, so it's kind of hard to tell when something was awake. Somnambulism is another name for sleepwalking. It takes place in stage 3 and 4. It usually only lasts a few minutes, and the individual is unaware that the episode took place. Once upon a time, my brother got up during the night. It was like 2 o'clock in the morning. I was in REM sleep. I woke up and, he woke me up. And so I followed him outside. I'm not saying anything. I don't know what's wrong with me. My brother and I didn't get along that well, but I saw him going outside and I was trying to figure out where he was going. And he went outside, and this was in Indiana, and Indiana has a lot of dew on the ground. This was in the summertime. There were dandelions. So dandelions are there in late May, early June. So that's when he went outside. It was in late May or early June. It's kind of cold, but there was dew on the ground, a lot of dew. It was almost like walking through through a creek or something. Anyway, so he goes and walks right out in the middle of the yard, sits down in the middle of the yard, in the middle of all this dew, all this water. And so I go out to follow him. I'm following him outside, and I walk out there, and it's wet. I mean, it's really wet. It was so wet that the cuffs of my pajama bottoms got wet, and it soaked all the way up to my knees. That's how wet it was out there. Lots and lots of water, and he's sitting right in the middle of it. And he stayed out there for about 15 minutes. And then he gets up and he walks back. He sat down in the middle of literally of a puddle and gets up, walks back, goes back to bed. And so I'm thinking, well, maybe I need to wake him up so that he can change his pajamas. And I grabbed a hold of his leg and he was dry as a bone. He didn't have any water on him at all. Me, on the other hand, I had to change my pajama bottoms because they were soaked all the way up to my knee. Now, how did he keep from getting wet? That's the question I've always asked myself. And I think the answer is probably that as we generate our own heat. And I imagine that what was happening was, I mean, he didn't seem cold. I was pretty cold. Of course, my pants were, or my pajamas were wet all the way up to my knee. But I think probably what happened was that he generated enough heat to keep himself dry. Other animals can do this, so why can't humans do it? And it was just, and I've told him this story before, and tells me that I was dreaming. Well, I wasn't dreaming. I still had those wet pajamas that I had to change. Anyway, so my brother, and that's the only time I ever followed him outside. I don't know if he was a sleepwalker or not, but he certainly was a sleepwalker that night. Sleep enuresis is another name for wetting the bed. It's a problem in some children, but it's especially a problem in boys. Little girls don't wet the bed nearly as much as little boys do. One method of reducing incidence of bed wetting is a nasal spray of vasopressin that reduces the amount of urine that accumulates during sleep. My grandson had this problem with enuresis, and I'm not sure how we cured it, but he had a bedwetting problem until probably a couple of years ago, and he's 9 years old, so don't tell anybody. This will probably come back and he'll get mad at me. He's 25 years old, and somebody says, "Oh, your grandfather was. I heard a lecture where it said that you wet the bed until you're 7." Gastric ulcers. Researchers have discovered that REM sleep can irritate or activate gastric ulcers. Sufferers of gastric ulcers secrete 3 to 20 times more acid during REM as a normal person. And of course, that could be the reason that they have gastric ulcers, is the fact that they produce a lot more of the digestive juices while they're asleep. Cardiovascular problems. Hospitals report that cardiac patients are more likely to die during the last 2 hours of sleep. Between 4 and 6 a.m., the period of the most intense REM episodes. And I can tell you from working in the morgue for a number of years, that was the worst time for us. We would get, so if they died at 4 o'clock in the morning, of course, and I'm working the graveyard shift. It wasn't called the graveyard shift because of this, but because everybody was asleep. We would always get them in just before the day shift came on. So there was always a flurry of these guys coming down from CCU and ICU. I say guys, but individuals would die during the graveyard shift, and people weren't dying during the day. You go in there and the morgue would be empty, and then by the time it was 8 o'clock the next morning and you were going home, the place would be just packed. Well, it would be full. I wouldn't say packed. Normally they took care of them during the day. I mean, they didn't get to stay in there unless they died of strange reasons, but we didn't have very many of those. Normally, it was somebody died of cardiac arrest or whatever. It was fairly, and they had to request an autopsy in order to do the autopsy. Somebody had to request the autopsy, and normally the doctor knew that the patient was probably not going to make it. So we just sign them out to the funeral home. Research also shows a concentration or connection between angina and REM sleep. This is something we also noticed. CCU used to get real busy, and this is one of the reasons why we needed a full staff at night, because CCU was always hopping at right as they went to sleep. And CCU we'd be called up to draw heart enzymes or whatever. As weird as that is, I guess it makes sense. Insomnia is commonly reported in older people and females and users of tobacco and users of coffee and users of alcohol. Sleep state perceptions is when an individual claims not to have slept, but EEG tracings show that they actually did sleep. So as you get older, you will get less and less sleep. Personally, I've got a Fitbit, so it tells me how long I was asleep. And it's usually right at 5 hours, a little bit over 5 hours, 5 hours and 7 minutes last week, 5 hours and 14 minutes the week before. I only sleep for 5 hours, but my wife sleeps for 7 or 8 hours. So the question is, do I have insomnia since I only sleep 5 hours a night? And the answer is not really, because even as a much younger man, I rarely got more than 6 hours of sleep a night. Sometimes 7 hours, but not very often. And certainly never 8 hours. I've never been an 8 hour sleeper. So there you go. As you get older, theoretically, you sleep less and less. I have no problems falling asleep. I have no problems waking up in the morning. I don't linger in bed after I wake up. I have no problems with sleeping at all. Sometimes my wife has problems falling asleep, but I don't. Some insomniacs show less REM sleep and more stage two sleep, a less restful state. Situational insomnia can be caused by shift work, time zone changes, novelty situations such as a hard motel bed. This was the problem my wife had. She just drove back from North Carolina and she stopped. She stopped on the way out and she stopped on the way back. And both nights she only slept for about 5 hours. That wasn't because she was so excited to get there and then excited to get home. It was because of the hotel, the motel bed. She just kind of rolled and rolled and rolled until she finally fell asleep. And we know this because she wears the Fitbit as well. So we know exactly. She's very sensitive about how much she sleeps because she suffers from sleep apnea. And knowing that she is sleeping is very important because of her sleep apnea. She needs to monitor this. These problems may cause sleep onset insomnia, difficulty falling asleep. Sleep maintenance insomnia is a condition where the individual has difficulty remaining asleep. Sleep apnea is a problem for people who've form, excuse me, it's a problem for people who form a respiratory obstruction when they sleep. As the night progresses, their oxygen level drops and the individual is kept from sleeping deeply by a choking feeling. This is common, this is a common problem with obese people, but it can happen to anyone who sleeps in a strange position. And that has been my wife's problem. The fact that she rolls over on her side and she'll hug the pillow and it doesn't feel right to her. Well, anyway, it seems to be a pillow problem as much as anything else. And that's one of the reasons why she has sleep apnea. So what will happen is she'll hyperextend her neck trying to fall asleep, and that kind of cuts off her airway. So what she does, she has a CPAP machine, and the CPAP blows air into her nose and keeps her airway open by blowing air into her nose. Most modern sleeping pills activate GABA receptors, inhibiting broad regions of the brain, but use of such medications as Halcyon may be a problem. Continual use of sleep induction, I'm sorry, inducing medication may lead to a reduction of its effectiveness and result in increased dosages that may be a health hazard. They change the pattern of sleep that lasts even after the cessation of use, and this can be a problem as well. They tend to reduce REM sleep, which accumulates with continued usage, causing an unpleasant rebound with cessation. The increase in GABA stays with the individual even when awake, causing a drowsy state known as sleep drunkenness. And this is a problem with taking sleeping pills or Valium. Not a good idea. Some researchers have suggested the use of melatonin, the hormone that is released by the pineal gland, to maintain the individual's circadian rhythm. Melatonin lowers body temperature, reducing arousal and causing drowsiness. Another method is to increase the level of serotonin in the system by administering tryptophan. Sleep delay is reduced without affecting the basic sleep pattern. Tryptophan, you find tryptophan in animal fat, in milk, in animal fat. Narcolepsy, this is an affliction where the individual has sudden attacks of sleep that last 5 to 30 minutes during waking hours, usually about every 90 minutes. These individuals are different than normal because they go into REM sleep at the onset of their sleep pattern instead of after 90 minutes. These individuals display cataplexy, loss of muscle, tone, sensory hallucinations, and sleep paralysis. The problem is often triggered when the individual becomes excited. It has been discovered that there are several breeds of dog with a mutated gene that causes the orexin neuropeptide to malfunction. Doberman Pinschers, Labrador Retrievers, and Dachshunds are three breeds where the mutation has been noted. Researchers have also produced mice without the orexin receptor who display similar symptoms. The cells that produce orexin reside in the hypothalamus. Recent rodent studies indicate that these cells connect to brain regions that are involved in sleep and wakefulness, including the locus coeruleus, raphe nuclei, tubero mammillary nucleus, and pontine reticular formation, among others. This evidence suggests that normally orexin helps the sleep and wakefulness areas carry out their jobs. The orexin-related abnormalities may impair their function. And I have a couple of videos. Let me tell you a quick story. Once upon a time, when I was in the service, we had an individual suffering from narcolepsy. And what happens with people with narcolepsy, if they get too excited, they fall asleep. And, of course, we were medics, and anytime emergencies would come in, this guy would sit down and fall asleep. And, of course, nobody thought anything about it. They thought he was tired. They thought he drank too much. They thought he had other problems. And initially, it turned out to be narcolepsy, which was not something that the military could tolerate. So they medically boarded him out of the service. Let me show you a couple videos, I think. There we go.
Thirty-six-year-old Nicole Giray is a member of the Ladies Professional Golf Association and has been for 13 years, but concentrating on her game became more and more difficult due to narcolepsy, a condition where a person's sleep and awake cycles are constantly interrupted.
I was diagnosed with narcolepsy in the height of my career. I was falling asleep all the time, and I would go to doctors and try to figure out what was wrong with me, and everybody kept saying that I just led a crazy lifestyle.
Yeah, sleep is controlled by an internal clock. And the brain actually has a little pacemaker behind the eyes. You have neurotransmitters in that pacemaker that fire. It's almost like an electrical circuit. That goes out to relay stations, and those relay stations have neurotransmitters or chemicals that relay this signal. And so the brain wakes up at a certain time. That signal lasts for a certain number of hours, And then when it begins to wear off, it shuts off, and another circuit inhibits wakefulness and promotes sleep.
Narcolepsy disrupts this function, and excessive daytime sleepiness is usually the first, most obvious symptom. But there are other symptoms that can be disturbing and very frightening, like cataplexy.
And cataplexy is the sudden loss of muscle tone or the development of muscle weakness, usually triggered by a strong emotional stimulus. More often than not, that emotional stimulus is laughter, happiness, joy, surprise. Sometimes it can be negative things like anger, fright, loud noises, but typically it's good things.
I was playing in a golf tournament, and whenever I would hit a good shot, I couldn't move afterwards. And I would stand there, and I was worried I was going to fall to the ground. And I was very worried because I thought there was, you know, a life-threatening condition. I wasn't sure what was wrong with me.
While many narcoleptics have cataplexy, not all of them do. Some have another symptom called automatic behavior.
I call it living in the twilight zone. If you were to stay up all night and try to function the next day, then you're tired and you're sleepy, and sometimes they'll have automatic activity. They may do something and not exactly remember that they did that, even drive.
I walked into the men's john one time, and the guy said, "You're not supposed to be in here." And I said, "Well, why not?" He said, "You're in the men's room." Oh, I was asleep. I had no idea what I was doing. So those were things that I used to do all the time.
There are treatments available that can make living with narcolepsy easier.
The medications that we have tend to improve alertness and stop the episodes of emotionally-induced muscle weakness. The ones that improve alertness tend to stimulate the cell groups in the brain that are important for keeping us awake. So they're not actually correcting the loss of the chemical, they're just aiding in our ability to remain awake.
Thanks to a combination of therapies, Nicole now has her narcolepsy under control.
I'm not falling asleep when I drive. I'm not falling asleep on the golf course ever. I never do that anymore. I've learned how to pay attention to my body and learn what keeps me more awake.
Oh, let's try another one. This is kind of mean. That's not right. The same one we just saw.
36-year-old.
I guess mean fiance. I guess I'm not going to show you the mean fiance. Okay.
Human Brainwaves, Part 2. The Biopsychological Effects of Ascension by Danny Searle. The brain has its own set of electrical frequencies it uses to communicate with itself and the rest of the body. The electroencephalograph, or EEG, measures brain waves of different frequencies within the brain. Waves can overlap somewhat, merging seamlessly into one another. Brain waves are measured in cycles per second. Raw EEG frequencies include gamma, beta, alpha, theta, and delta. These frequencies are linked to behaviors, subjective feeling states, and psychological correlates. The frequency bands and waves characteristics are described as follows. Gamma waves, 25 to 60 Hz. Gamma waves relate to simultaneous processing of information from different brain areas. They are involved in memory, learning abilities, integrated thoughts, or information task processing. Gamma rhythms modulate perception and consciousness, which disappear with anesthesia. Beta waves, 12 to 25 Hz. Beta waves dominate our normal waking state of consciousness when attention is directed towards cognitive tasks and the outside world. Beta is the fast activity, present when we are alert or even anxious, or when engaged in problem solving, judgment, decision making, information processing, mental activity, and focus. Alpha waves, 7 to 12 hertz. Alpha waves are triggered during dreaming and light meditation when the eyes are closed. As more and more neurons are recruited to this frequency, alpha waves cycle globally across the whole cortex. This induces deep relaxation. In alpha, we begin to access the wealth of creativity that lies just below our conscious awareness. It is the gateway, the entry point that leads into deeper states of consciousness. Alpha waves aid overall mental coordination, calmness, alertness, inner awareness, mind-body integration, and learning. Alpha is the home of Schumann's resonance, 7.83 Hz. When we intentionally generate alpha waves, we go into resonance with the Earth's frequency. We naturally feel better, refreshed, in tune, and in sync. In fact, it's environmental synchronization. That is why you feel relaxed and at peace when you're in the country or on a secluded beach. Your brain is resonating with the Earth. Theta waves, 4 to 7 hertz. Theta waves occur most often in sleep, but are also dominant in the deepest states of meditation. In theta, our senses are withdrawn from the external world and focused on the mindscape, internally originating signals. Theta meditation. Theta waves are associated with mystery. It is that twilight state which we normally only experience fleetingly as we rise from the depths of delta upon waking or drifting off to sleep. Theta meditation increases creativity, enhances learning, reduces stress, and awakens intuition and other extrasensory perception skills. Delta waves, 0 to 4 hertz. Delta waves are the slowest but highest in amplitude. They are generated in the deepest meditation and dreamless sleep. Delta waves confer a suspension of external existence and provide the most profound feelings of peace. In addition, certain frequencies within the delta range trigger the release of a growth hormone, which is beneficial for the healing and regeneration process. This is why deep restorative sleep is so essential in the healing process. Brain waves affect the way we feel, our health, and our ability to learn. Alpha waves induce feelings of peace and harmony, and just happen to be the same frequencies as Schumann's resonance. This is no coincidence. After all, our brains did evolve on this planet within the Schumann's cavity. However, as we have learnt, the Schumann's resonance is rising, so our brain waves are no longer in sync with the Earth. Join me for part 3 to learn what direct effects to our health are caused by this out of sync between...
Yeah, okay. Sorry about that. Yeah, that had to do with meditation, but it also taught you where... each electrical impulse, how it, the hertz level of each electrical impulse. Schumann's resonance has to do with the fact that the Earth actually has produces noise, vibrations, and that's Schumann's resonance that they were talking about, which is a curiosity. That should be the end of the... Oops. That should be the end. Yep, that's the end of the chapter. Let's get rid of this and go to the next chapter, chapter 15, Emotions, Aggression, and Stress. They're filling my propane tank, so my dog is a bit excited. He gets to be in here with me. The emotions have four aspects: feelings, actions, physiological arousal, and motivational programs. As far as actions are concerned, emotions often trigger action and are intensified by the presence of the feelings. Facial expressions are also demonstrative to others and may act as a warning mechanism. As far as physiological arousal, somatic and automatic responses are what we're dealing with here. Intensity, emotions tend to have intensities from low to high. Happiness, joy, ecstasy are the low to high. Regard, affection, adoration, apprehension, fear, terror, distraction, surprise, amazement, pensiveness, sadness, and grief, boredom, disgust, loathing, annoyance, anger, rage, alertness, expectation, vigilance. And those are the intensities of select emotions. Reading literature pre-20th century, it was fairly obvious that folk psychology felt that the feelings caused the physical reaction. James Lange theory, William James and Carl Lange, however, believed that the feelings were a reaction to the physical changes. Thus, fleeing from an enemy causes fear and smiling causes happiness. James and Lange were aware that often there is a delay in feelings after the physiological responses. And this is the James Lange theory. Now, William James was an American psychologist from Harvard, and Carl Lange was a neurophysiologist from Sweden. But they came up with their theory about at the same time, and that's since, you know, we could argue back and forth, oh, it's William James's theory, no, it's Carl Lange's theory. They just called it the James Lange theory, since both of them came out at the same time. Normally, it's the guy that publishes first that wins, but in this case, of course, one came out of Europe, the other came out of the United States, and that was the argument. People in Europe said, no, it's a Lange's theory, and people in the United States said, no, it's a James theory. And eventually, of course, they just put them both together, so it's a James Lange theory of emotion. Later on, Cannon and Bard, Walter Cannon and Philip Bard refuted the James Lange theory. Cannon and Bard discovered that the experience of the emotion started before the autonomic changes. Not only that, but often the autonomic changes are identical for different emotions, readying the individual for fight or flight. Cannon and Bard felt that it was the cerebral cortex's responsibility to find the appropriate emotion to fit the circumstances. Work by Stanley Schachter showed that both theories are correct in certain and select circumstances and incorrect in select circumstances. Schachter injected individuals with epinephrine. That's the hormone that is secreted during fight or flight, which made individuals react emotionally, and that fit the James Lange theory. So if you inject somebody with epinephrine, all of a sudden they will become emotional. But in the same circumstance, if a Confederate acted with a select emotion in the presence of the individual displayed the bogus emotion, and that fits the Cannon-Bard theory. And now we have some emotions. The one on the left, you can identify. She looks pensive. The one on the right, the baby is smiling. He's happy. The individual on the left looks angry. The individual on the right, that is a fake smile. Individual on the left, that is rage. Individual on the right is disgust. That's disgust. I don't know what that one is. The one on the left is disgust. The one on the right is fear. Number 9 is worry. Number 10 is surprise. Number 11 is also surprise. Number 12 is, she's just getting married and she's winking at us, so you can take that one for whatever emotion you want. Number 13 is bored. And number 14 is one that you run into in Indian country. It's called snapping your eyes. So she's snapping her eyes at us. She's angry. She's trying to tell us something is wrong. Number 15 is, wait a minute. Number 15 is a real smile, and number 16 is a fake smile, I believe. That's the same lady. Number 17, happy again, and number 18 is happy, I guess. Facial expressions, there are 7 facial expressions that are recognized in almost all cultures around the world. Anger, sadness, happiness, fear, disgust, surprise, and contempt. And now we're going to watch a film about facial expressions. And listen to Billy Joel play the piano, man.
It's 9 o'clock on a Saturday. A regular crowd shuffles in. There's an old man sitting next to me, making love to his tonic and gin. He says, son, can you play me a memory? I'm not really sure how it goes, but it's sad and it's sweet, and I knew it complete when I wore a younger man's clothes. La 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 la. Sing us a song, you're the piano man. Sing us a song tonight. Well, we're all in the mood for a melody, and you've got us feeling all right. Now John at the bar is a friend of mine. Gets me my drinks for free, and he's quick with a joke or to light up your smoke, but there's some place that he'd rather be. He says, Bill, I believe this is killing me, as a smile ran away from his face. Well, I'm sure that I could be a movie star if I could get out of this place. Oh, la, 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 di, di, da. La, la, di, di, da, da. Now Paul is a real estate novelist who never had time for a wife. And he's talking with David, who's still in the Navy and probably will be for life. Practicing politics as the businessmen slowly get stoned. Yes, they're sharing a drink they call loneliness, but it's better than drinking alone. All right,
reading body language. This is kind of interesting.
Well, hello, Internet. Welcome to my presentation on gestures and body language. Kelly B23 wrote me and asked, do you know how to read gestures and body language? If so, teach me. In this presentation, I will do just that. What I did was I studied over 25 psychology and law enforcement training manuals. I discovered what they all agreed with and put it all into this one presentation. I want to start off first with the eyes. A person's eyes dilate strongly when they are very stimulated and in a problem-solving mode. At maximum dilation, the person is ready to make a decision, which is most likely going to be positive. An eyebrow raise is a sign that a person isn't threatening. When you actually raise your eyebrows to somebody, even if they're a complete stranger, they'll often smile. This is a very submissive sign, or at least is perceived that way. Whenever you first meet somebody, the first person to look away is considered to be the most submissive. If a person is maintaining strong eye contact, they are either, one, interested in you if their eyes are dilated, or challenging you if their eyes are constricted. The most threatening look is achieved by moving narrowed eyes towards a person with little to no body movement. The speed of this head movement will demonstrate how angry that person is. Liars maintain strong eye contact with people. It should actually become uncomfortable at some point. If someone gives you a sideways glance, look at their eyebrows. If they're raised, they like you. If not, they don't. If a person's blink rate increases, this is considered a sure sign of lying. If a person's eyes are darting around, they're either getting bored or nervous. When first meeting a person, shake hands with strong eye contact and then give them at least 3 seconds to look at you uninterrupted to generate the best rapport. To build strong rapport, you should look them in the eyes somewhere between 60 to 70% of the time. This is a really interesting chart. A lot of people don't know this, but whenever people are trying to remember something, they'll look in certain directions. So, for example, if a person looks upwards and to your right, they're trying to remember something they visually saw. And if they look sideways and to the right, they're trying to remember something they heard. Down and to the right is whenever a person is talking to themselves. And if they're either trying to construct something that they've never seen, or they're planning on lying to you, they'll look up and to the left. Down and to the left is where a person looks whenever they are feeling something or remembering an action. You might be asking yourself, or you might be thinking to yourself right now, well, I just feel more comfortable with my arms crossed in front of me, for example, or some other thing. What you have to understand is if you feel comfortable with a specific body position, it is because you're feeling a certain way. Ask yourself, for example, when would you feel comfortable with your arms crossed while enjoying yourself with a loved one? Or even better yet, have you ever seen anyone cross their arms in excitement? Now on to handshaking. When shaking someone's hand, if their hand is on top, they're trying to dominate you, which means that they literally take your hand and flip it so that your palm is facing towards the ceiling. Also, if they grip it like a vice, that also means they're trying to dominate you. An equal handshake in which both people shake in a vertical manner with equal pressure is the best way to generate good rapport. Do not shake with both hands or touch any other part of the body unless you have an intimate relationship with this person. At most, a brief touch to the elbow, which is considered a non-intimate part of the body, during a handshake has been shown to generate very good feelings and generate very good rapport. A valuable clue to whether a person is being open and honest is whether they're showing their palms or not. So to elaborate, honesty equals palm displays. If a person says they can't do something and they show you their hands, they're telling you the truth. And what's better yet, if you talk with a lot of palm displays, you'll actually force the people you're talking to be more truthful. Hands clenched in front of a person means they're holding back a negative reaction. Holding one's wrist behind their back is an attempt at self-control. And if a person places their head on their open hands as if on a platter, they're saying that they admire you. This, by the way, is the best body position if you want to attract people to yourself. If a person's picking imaginary lint, they have a secret opinion more than likely that they don't want to tell you. Hands folded in front, hand in hand, shows that you are feeling vulnerable. Pointing at a person is one of the most annoying gestures. You should also never rub your thumb to your forefinger around people. This is considered the symbol for money. Rubbing the hands together shows that you are expecting something positive, and it has been shown that the speed at which a person rubs their hands will demonstrate how good they expect the results to be. The steeple hand gesture represents that you are confident and self-assured. This gesture should be used sparingly. However, if you want to guarantee a look of confidence, this is the look. By pressing your forefinger to your thumb, you will come off as authoritative, but not aggressive. What I mean by this is, instead of pointing with one finger, instead, take your pointer finger, place it on your thumb, and point in that way instead. You'll actually see President Obama do this very often. Holding hands behind your back shows that you're confident, but you feel superior. The reason why is you're exposing all the delicate parts of your body, being the groin, stomach, and throat, all at the same time. Hands on hips show that you're preparing to dominate unless the elbows are held close to the body. In this case, it would be a submissive position. If a person tucks their thumbs in their pants rather than rest their hands on their hips, they're being very aggressive. Thumbs protruding from pockets shows that the person feels they're superior to you. We fold our arms in front of ourselves when we feel either threatened, don't like, or trust something. When you fold your arms, you lose credibility with people. If you're folding your arms while grasping your biceps, it shows that you're feeling very insecure. If you clench your fists while folding your arms, people will see you as being hostile. And arms crossed with thumbs turned up shows that a person is warming up to you. Now I'd like to go into invisible walls. A woman will often create an invisible wall with a purse by placing that purse between them and the person that they do not trust. If a person puts a drink on the opposite side of the hand in which they're drinking, that also creates an invisible wall because they have to continually keep reaching across their chest to get the drink. You can gain a lot of information by studying people's legs. The reason why is information you gain by studying leg and feet positions is extremely useful because people have little control over them. This is why most meetings feel only comfortable if two people have their legs hidden by a table or desk. If you want to appear young and vibrant, you should always walk quickly while swinging your arms. Also, it has been shown that people's feet will point towards that which they want. Always offer people a hot cup of coffee. The hotter, the better. This makes it difficult to remain crossed up without burning themselves. I know this is kind of sadistic, but... Another tip to get a person to unlock themselves is to ask them positive questions to get them to tell you what they're feeling. Never cross your legs and then have both hands cradled behind your head. This is an extremely off-putting, especially to women. Here are some additional negative leg positions. Jiggling of the feet is a sign that the person wants to get away from a situation. Open and uncrossed legs show you are prepared to dominate, while crossed legs show that you're closed off or uncertain. If legs are crossed, the knee points towards that which you prefer, and you should never ask a person to make a decision if their legs and arms are both crossed at the same time. If a person has their legs crossed and they're holding them in place with their hands, they are feeling very stubborn. And a person that locks their ankles together is essentially biting their lip. If a person locks one foot around their calf or thigh, they're showing signs of timidness. And if a person sits oddly in a chair, they're showing that they don't see you as being important. If, however, they flip the chair around and place the back of the chair towards you, they're using the back of the chair as a shield and again plan on dominating you or strongly disagree with what you're saying. Here are some positive leg positions. Women specifically cross and uncross their legs around people that they like. More specifically, they cross their legs in a parallel manner when they really like someone. If, as you speak to somebody, that one of their feet continually keeps moving closer and closer to you, that means that they are feeling a strong connection. You can check to see that a smile is sincere by checking for wrinkles at the eyes. If you smile at a person, they will return the favor more than likely. And people that smile a lot often will receive very positive reactions from others. When a person is smiling, they're often more likely to be telling the truth as well. And a false smile will often appear stronger on one side of the face versus the other. Tight-lipped smiles, on the other hand, in which teeth are not shown, tell you that the person is trying to keep a secret. And a smile in which the person has their head turned down and their eyes aimed upward is used to show that the person is attracted to you. Laughing is very attractive and makes you as well as others feel comfortable. Laughter has more to do with bonding than humor, though, however. And as many people know, yawning is used by people to build rapport and avoid aggression. Well, that's the end of the presentation. Hope you liked it. If you have any questions or you have a question you'd like me to research, leave it in the comment section below. Till next time.
Okay. Wow. Lots of information. Maybe. There we go. Facial expressions are created by two sets of facial muscles, the superficial facial muscles and the deep facial muscles. Superficial facial muscles change the shape of the mouth, the eyes, or nose and pull in their attached skin. The frontalis muscle wrinkles the forehead and raises the eyebrows. Of the deep facial muscles, they're attached to the skeletal structure of the head. They enable the individual to chew. The masseter is a powerful jaw muscle. Of course, this is the masseter. The masseter is tied up to the top of your head and goes all the way down to your chin. And that's what allows you to bite down hard. Human facial muscles are innervated by two cranial nerves, the V2. Innervates the superficial muscles of the facial expression. The trigeminal nerve innervates muscles that move the jaw. And you can see, here's V3 right there. Oops, I don't have an arrow. Right and left nerves are completely independent, allowing the person to wink and crinkle one corner of their mouth. Bell's palsy is caused by an irritation of the nerves on one side of your face. Depending where the Bell's palsy originates, just a small portion of the entire side of the face can be affected. Dental work often causes the problem, but the condition is rarely permanent. Usually the nerves will come back after the swelling in the area goes down. Colds can cause this problem. When I was in the service, we had an individual who had a dental procedure done, and it gave him Bell's palsy. It looked like he had a stroke, because one side of his face, he had a difficult time dealing with one side of his face. It was almost like the Novocaine lasted for 4 or 5 weeks, but he had Bell's palsy. Through studies with animals and emotionally disturbed humans, researchers have discovered an area of the brain that deals with emotion. The limbic system in the center of the brain seems to control emotion. The limbic system includes the basal forebrain nuclei, the mammillary body, olfactory bulb, amygdala, hippocampus, parahippocampal gyrus, cingulate gyrus, and anterior nucleus of the dorsal thalamus. And all of those are in this area. And I don't have, wait a second. I don't have an arrow. There, I have one. Okay, this in this area. This is what we're talking about. Studies using electrodes implanted in the brain have discovered that most areas of the brain do not produce positive reactions. However, positive brain sites do seem to be concentrated in the hypothalamus. The most apparent area is a large tract that ascends from the midbrain to the hypothalamus, a region referred to as the medial forebrain bundle. This area seems to have something to do with food-seeking behavior in lower animals. Physicians have noted the differences of people that with localized cerebrovascular accidents, that strokes or hemorrhages. Medically, it's called a cerebrovascular accident. Colloquially, it's called a stroke. And they can affect emotional reactions. A stroke in the right parietal or temporal lobe causes undue cheerfulness or joking, denial of illness, and apathy. That is not that common. Strokes in the left frontal lobe, especially in the basal ganglia, can cause depressed mood, daily mood variations, loss of energy, anxiety, restlessness, worry, weight loss, decreased appetite, early morning awakening, delayed sleep onset, social withdrawal, irritability. And this is the frontal lobe, of course. Bilateral hemispheric lesions or any lesions in the brain can cause frequent brief laughing and or crying that is not caused by sadness, social withdrawal secondary to emotional outbursts. Strokes in the right basotemporal or right orbitofrontal region can cause elevated moods, increased energy, increased appetite, decreased sleep, feeling of well-being, pressured speech, flight of ideas, and grandiose thoughts, almost like bipolar disorder. Studies looking at the fear response in animals and humans have discovered that the amygdala, part of what used to be called the reptilian brain, is a structure that mediates fear. Pictures of fear, inducing images shown to individuals will elicit blood flow to the amygdala. And of course, these are the amygdala right here. You have two, one on each side of your brain. When a woman without an amygdala was shown a picture of a woman smiling, she recognized happy. When the same woman was shown a picture of a woman registering fear, she didn't recognize the emotion. She recognized this, but she didn't recognize that. Researchers looking at aggression have discovered that cross-species elevated androgens means elevated aggressive tendencies. Androgens, of course, are the male hormone. Supporting evidence, when a male subject species is castrated and androgens, androgens and aggression both will drop. Injecting testosterone into the castrated individual leads to increased aggression. So we know that androgens affect emotion, or aggression anyway. In a study looking at female prisoners, it was found that women in prison for unprovoked violence have higher testosterone levels than women in prison for defensive aggression. Similar results were found with veterans showing antisocial behavior. The more aggressive behavior, the higher the testosterone level. studies of monkeys in lowered levels of serotonin show that there is a negative correlation between serotonin and aggressive behavior. The lower the serotonin, the more aggressive the individual is. However, serotonin is not the only neurotransmitter that controls aggression. Hormones that control testosterone levels and the GABA system also play a role. And this is one of the reasons why serotonin not only controls aggression, it also controls sexual behavior. So a male that has a problem with aggressive behavior or with sexual behavior, if they can increase the serotonin level, usually that will modulate his behavior. We already know that high serotonin levels will cause impotence in select individuals. The reason is because the testosterone, the level of testosterone, has to do with your sexual response. Level of testosterone in the hypothalamus has to do with your sexual response. Increasing serotonin increases serotonin in the hypothalamus, and that will control the individual's sexual behavior to the point of it not being there at all. Immunity. This is something really, really, really important as far as what we're going through, the pandemic that we're going through right now. The stronger your immunity, the less likely you are to get COVID. One of the things that we have discovered, actually we knew this before, but nobody was talking about it, mainly because they didn't want to stigmatize one person over another. Now we know that different blood types represent different levels or different types of immunity. One of the things we've discovered from COVID is that individuals who are more susceptible to autoimmune diseases are more likely to have problems with if they get sick from COVID. People with type A blood are more likely to contract and to die from COVID-19. Why? We're not exactly sure what it has to do. Well, we know what it has to do with your immune system. Different immune systems are different. People with type O blood have a certain strength of immunity. People with type A blood tend to have a very strong immunity, but the problem is they overreact to an infection. So let's talk about immunity. The first line of defense as far as immunity is concerned, it's not really your first line. Your first line is your skin. But internally, if you ingest a toxin, a pathogen, then it's your red blood or your white blood cells in your blood, and there are several different types of white blood cells. This is one of the things that I did when I was working in medicine. I was a laboratory technician, and I did differentials. I differentiated the different types of white cells, and these are the different types of white cells. These globs right here are red cells, and as you can see, they kind of look like donuts, or they're supposed to look like donuts. These little purple dots right here, these are, thrombocytes. They're thrombocytes. They are what make you clot, these little bitty blue spots. Okay, so these other blue circles are the white cells, and this is the different shapes they are. As you can see, some of them are fairly distinctive. It's a lot easier to identify this cell and this cell. If you saw these two cells, you'd say, oh, that's a neutrophil, and you'd say, oh, that's a lymphocyte. A little bit more difficult is to tell the difference between a monocyte and a lymphocyte because they look a lot alike. These are more neutrophils. These two over here are what we refer to as basophils. And the reason they're basophils is because they have such a dark cytoplasm. As you can see, they have very dark purple dots. They're very similar to the lymphocytes, except for these big purple, or the purple dots, and that makes them basophils. And then the eosinophils. Eosin is actually an orange stain, and these stain orange, and they look a lot like neutrophils, but they're orange. The cytoplasm is orange, and these are pink. So it's fairly easy if you have a good stain and you do a good stain on your cells, you can really tell the difference between a basophil, an eosinophil, a neutrophil, a monocyte, and a lymphocyte. And each one of them does something totally different. So when we're talking about a viral infection, when we're talking about COVID-19, or we're talking about mononucleosis, what we're talking about is a viral infection. Most colds are caused by viruses. Smallpox, whooping cough is caused by a bacteria. But most of the problems that have killed off so many people in the world are all lymphocytes and they're viruses. So each one, when there is an invasion of something, then we get an overabundance of those types of white cells that can destroy whatever it is that's trying to invade the body. HIV, for example, is a viral infection, and actually it's a retrovirus, and the lymphocytes are increased. So if we go through this whole list, these big purple dots, they attack heavy metals and other metal toxins. So if somebody has lead poisoning, we'll see an overabundance of these. When I was in the service, the individuals who refueled the airplanes with JP4, we used JP4 at that point. I think we're using something else right now, JP6 or something. Anyway, there was lead in it. And if they had been on the flight line for an extended length of time, a lot of times we would draw their blood. We had to draw their blood to make sure they weren't getting lead poisoning. And if they were getting lead poisoning, we would have an overabundance of these basophils. So that's what we're looking for. Eosinophils have to do with allergies. It also has to do with parasites. If somebody has had pinworms, they'll have an increase of eosinophils, these orange guys over here. If it's spring and the pollen is out and you're allergic to pollen, then we'll get an increase of eosinophils. There's a commercial about eosinophils causing overreaction to, the lung disease, the lung problem. I can't think of it. Anyway, it causes an overreaction. And yeah, there can be an overreaction. Asthma. That is an overreaction to allergens. So we get an increase of eosinophil. So if we think you have a parasite, we can draw your blood and we can look and see if there are lots of these guys or if there's not very many at all. Normally, there's only 2 or 3%. If you have 5 to 10%, then it means you're probably allergic to something and something is causing you to increase the number of eosinophils. Lymphocytes have to do with viruses. So if you have If you're infected with HIV, if you've got COVID, we could draw your blood and we would see lots and lots of these guys over here. As a matter of fact, we would see immature forms. And the immature forms in this case are the ones with the large cytoplasms. These are older ones. These are older lymphocytes. But these are the new ones. And we would see a lot of the new ones, which look an awful lot like monocytes, except monocytes are a little bit bigger. But you have to see the two of them together to be able to identify the monocytes. It's really kind of curious because they stain very similar. Neutrophils fight off bacteria. So if you had whooping cough or you cut your leg and Staph aureus got in there or beta strep group A got in there, you would have this huge increase of the number of neutrophils. if you had a an appendicitis. This is how we used to diagnose appendicitis. We draw your blood, and if you had a huge increase in white cells, like doubled the number of white cells you normally have, and most of them were these guys, then and you had a pain in your right lower quadrant, we would we'd probably think that you had an appendicitis. So anytime you need to fight off bacteria, these guys increase. If we look at somebody that's healthy, that somebody that doesn't have any kind of an infection, what we will see is about 55% of these guys, 35% of these guys, and then the rest of them, that's 90, yeah, the rest of them are monocytes, eosinophils, and basophils. Not that many of any of these. And then the monocytes fight cancer. These are phagocytes. The monocytes, they engulf things that need to be engulfed, and that's what the monocytes do. Okay. The immune system is very adaptive and maintains itself through several structures. The B lymphocytes comprise the humoral immune system. These cells are produced in the long bones, the B lymphocytes. B cells produce antibodies or immunoglobulins that either directly neutralize the antigens of the foreign body or enhance the destruction of other cells. And these are known as B lymphocytes. B lymphocytes, okay. Cell-mediated immunity involves lymphocytes formed or converted in the thymus behind the heart. There are three kinds of T cells, T helper cells that produce interleukin and lymphokines, T killer cells which go to an invader and engulfs it, it kills it, and T suppressor cells which suppress humoral reactions because we can get an overreaction. And of course, that's what's happening with COVID. A lot of times people aren't dying from the infection as much as they're dying from the overreaction of their body to the infection, as weird as that sounds. Now, let me explain something to you. When you get a cold, when you get a rhinovirus in your nasal passage and it causes you to have a cold, the rhinovirus only lasts for a day or two. The rest of that 5 or 6 days of blowing your nose and having copious amounts of fluid coming out of your nose is because of an overreaction. Your body is trying to get rid of the rhinovirus, which it already has done, but it's an overreaction. Much of it is an overreaction. You can tell the difference between when you're just overreacting to something or when you really have an active infection by the color of your mucus, whether it tastes funny, whether it's thick, the viscosity of it. The thicker it is, the more likely that you have an infection. So if you had a sinus infection, for example, if you had a bacterial sinus infection, then the mucus coming out of your nose would be thick, it would be green or yellow, and it would not be clear. It would be opaque. There would be something in there. You could see that there's something in there. And of course, that's one of the reasons why mucus is so important. And oddly, of course, doctors don't ever look at this stuff. But as laboratory technicians, of course, we would. That was one of the things that we did. So we would get a sputum specimen, and we would culture it. And if they had some kind of an infection, of course, it would grow. We would be able to grow the bacteria. Well, we saw the sputum, and we knew that if it was clear, then we weren't going to get anything to grow, anything that was pathogenic anyway. We knew that if it was opaque, if it was white, gray, green, yellow, we knew that we're going to get some kind of bacterial growth. We didn't grow viruses. We only grew bacteria because viruses are a lot harder to grow. And we didn't have that capability. This is back 50, 40, 40, 50 years ago. So, yeah, things were a little bit different back then. Anyway, so we've got all these cells that are trying to fight off infections. Okay, so Europeans, they first come over to the New World, and by golly, lo and behold, all of the diseases that that they have killed off just probably 99% of all indigenous people in this area. And what? So what happened? Well, the problem was immunity, because the Europeans grew up with or evolved with different animals, and the different animals had different diseases, like pigs and cows. They had different diseases. They passed the diseases back and forth between each other, and they mutated to become pretty pathogenic, pretty ridiculously pathogenic. So when they came over to the New World, when they came over to the Americas, the people in the Americas didn't have the immunity that they had, because they had never seen pigs. They'd never seen cows before. And of course, it was the pigs and cows that were becoming infected with virus, select viruses, smallpox, measles, mumps, chicken pox. You know, all of these are viruses. They were all causing different problems. And since indigenous peoples had no immunity to it, it was killing them. And it was killing them in masses, because there was absolutely no immunity whatsoever. So a lot of people died. And that was the reason why. It was because the Europeans lived with their animals, and they were passing the diseases, the human diseases, to the animal, the animals passing it back to the humans in a mutated form. That's what happens every year in with the flu. Why can't we just come up with a vaccine that takes care of the flu forever, and so we never have to have it? Well, the answer is because there's at least two different types of flu, the A and the B, influenza A and influenza B, and we never know which one's coming back, is coming over here. We don't know whether this is a virus that is 45% A and 55% B, or whether it's 20% A and 80% B. We never know that. And so why in the world does it come back in different forms? Well, the influenza always comes out of Asia. And the reason it comes out of Asia is because Asians live with their pigs. They live with pigs. And pigs are very similar. They have a very similar immune system to us. So if you feed your pigs or allow your pigs to root around in human waste, then the pig will get the virus and it will mutate. A lot of times it doesn't hurt the pig at all, but it is passed back to humans. Of course, that's one of the reasons why we're trying to figure out where COVID came from. Did it come from bats? Did it come from pangolins? We know it came from the Wuhan district of China. But you know, what animal was the vector? What animal caused it to mutate to be so virulent in humans? And of course, this is a question that we have to answer so that we can stop it for the next time. A lot of times it's bat. It has to do with bats. Sometimes it has to do with pigs. In this case, it's a wild animal called the pangolin, which looks a lot like a pig with a long fleshy tail. You know, at first they said it came out of a wet, a place where they keep live animals, to sell them and butcher them. And, this is referred to as bushmeat in Africa. I'm not sure what they call it in Asia. Anyway, this all has to do with immunity, and it has to do with where diseases come from. It's kind of fascinating. Besides B cells and T cells, a major leukocyte in circulation is a cell that does not require an antigen to trigger the immune response. The natural killer cell, or NK cell, is a free-floating granular lymphocyte that recognizes stressed or alien cells and destroys them without the antigen-antibody connection. The cell is produced in besides the thymus, or the bone marrow, the spleen, and the tonsils. A lot of people have their tonsils taken out because they become infected. You only need, your tonsils are kind of there so because of all these childhood diseases that people have. When I was young, just about everybody had their tonsils taken out because they would become infected. And they'd take out the tonsils. They don't take out tonsils now unless they do become infected. So most people are wandering around with their tonsils. I was okay with my tonsils until I was about 20 years old, and then I started getting frequent colds that I couldn't get rid of. So they figured, well, we'll take out his tonsils. They took out my tonsils. I almost bled to death. So I don't have tonsils. And then when I was in 1985, I was playing in a soccer game, and I had my spleen ruptured, and now I don't have a spleen. So I don't have I don't have tonsils, and I don't have a spleen, which means that that's normally where these guys sit around. They just sit around in your spleen or your tonsils, and they wait for an infection to occur. But I don't have a spleen, and I don't have tonsils, so I've got all these natural killer cells just floating around in my blood. I don't have any place to sit, so they have to just circulate. And the weird part is that I never get sick. I don't catch colds. I don't catch the flu. I haven't had a flu shot forever. I did get vaccinated for COVID, and I'm going to get the booster shot if I can figure out where to get one. Anyway, I rarely get sick, and this may have something to do with the fact that these guys are just kind of wandering around in my system, whereas you guys have them sitting around in your spleen. Spleen's a good thing. It holds all these. It holds extra red cells. It holds extra white cells, waiting for something to happen. While most of the leukocytes circulating in the body are granulocytes. Granulocytes are neutrophils that fight off bacteria. Various organs will act as staging areas or modification areas in case of a viral invasion. The spleen is a major staging and modification organ in the body. The spleen normally contains 40% of the NK cells, 25% of the B cells, and 10% of the T cells. And I do not have a spleen, so my spleen isn't holding these guys waiting for something to happen. All these cells are just floating around my system. 40% of the T cells and 40% of the B cells are located in the lymph nodes for rapid modification. The lungs are a major staging area for lymphocytes, holding 35% of the NK cells and 10% of the T cells, possibly to combat the respiratory viruses. During times of stress, the immune system is suppressed. While on the surface, this may not make sense, one must remember that the immune system marshals a great deal of resources. When in a flee or fight or die situation, death will occur if the organism does not marshal all its resources to survive the encounter, thus a suppressed immune system. So we need to suppress the immune system. Otherwise, you may not have the energy, the wherewithal to fight off whatever it is that you need to fight off. People under a great deal of stress over a long period of time are more susceptible to select infections. They're more susceptible to fatigue, to muscle wasting, to hypertension, ulcers, loss of libido, suppression of ovulation, impotency in males, and accelerated aging. Psychology and medicine have melded at various times since the advent of psychology. Medical doctors are very aware that some people may think that they are sick, but actually aren't. This problem is known as a psychosomatic condition, and the medicine dealing with it is referred to as psychosomatic medicine. Health psychology is a field of how psychology may influence good health. Psychoneuroimmunology studies the immune system and its interaction with the nervous system and human behavior. And that is the end of the chapter. Fascinating stuff. Of course, it's especially fascinating for me because I worked in this field for 30 years. So it's and I don't have a spleen. I guess that makes it kind of interesting as well. Anyway, I'll see you guys next week. We'll tackle chapter 16. We'll only have singletons from now on, only one chapter at a time. So I'll talk to you guys next week.